to introduce Ernesto Lupercio from Sin the Staff,
aka
no, no, it's aka Ernesto Lupercio from Sin the Staff. So he will tell us about modeling quantum storage geometry.
Well, it's a bit of an improvised talk, so I encourage you to ask questions. It will also be a short talk.
Can you please talk louder? We can't hear it on the Zoom.
If you can speak louder, Ernesto.
There's also a microphone.
Well, I'm so glad that mine wasn't taped.
That was the voice in the computer.
Mina, how are you doing?
I'm good. This is replacing the lecture tomorrow, or that's additional one?
No. This is not replacing my real lecture. This is my paid lecture. Someone had to cancel.
I see. Okay.
So I'll try to give just an entertaining little lecture. It's not planned. It's really informal. So I encourage you to ask questions. I will just give an impressionistic picture on this story. But this story dovetails with the story tomorrow, and it motivates the story from tomorrow. So altogether, I mean, it actually has a thematic consistency and continuity. And it explains why one would go from the realms of combinatorics, non-combinatorial geometry, to complex geometry and intimations into new kinds of Hodge theories, and so on and so forth. So all this story will explain why one would want to use particular kinds of logic to deal with these issues. So let me start and tori are important. And in algebraic geometry and complex geometry and symplectic geometry, there is this particularly simple variety. There are generalizations, say, of projective space. If you think of projective space, you can think of it that you have a big complex story, C star cross C star cross C star cross C star, and you compactify it somehow, and then you obtain projective space. The simplest instance of this is the C star. Right? 0 and infinity, and then you get the Riemann sphere, and this is the one-dimensional projective space. And then you could do it for CP2, but you could have C star cross C star, and you have to compactify somehow to the CP2. But observe that already in the two-dimensional case, where you have C star cross C star, you have options. You could compactify to two parallel to CP1 cross CP1. And this would be different than CP2. Not horrendously different from the vibration point of view, but different. Complex manifolds, varieties, cohomologically different. CP2 has one CP1 there, but CP1 plus CP1 cut clearly to other there. The cohomology would be different, so on and so forth, etc. So already for C star cross C star, you have many ways to compactify C star cross C star into smooth complex manifolds. And they are all very different from certain points of view. And now it is interesting that that you immediately realize, very quickly realize that you have all this combinatorial gain. How to use compactification is classical for the judge. The basic idea in quantum toric geometry is that this is self destroy button here. Yeah, you just turned the whole thing. So And then just next to the presentation button, there is a self-destroyer. You can explode. So you have the, so what's the classical toric picture like this? You have this toric variety. So you have C-star, cross C-star, in this case, C-star, cross C-star. And then this piece of combinatorial geometry, classical Euclidean combinatorial geometry, with arithmetics, encodes the way where you are going to compactify C star cross C star. In this case, well, these are two, and if it was R n, it was C star cross C star. So it's a classical, but right, it's a classical moment now. Because this variety will be compact, because this is a complete fun picture, it's covered the whole. There's this fun that is kind of dual to this polytope, or from the tropical perspective, you know, the polytope would have infinite size, it wouldn't have a particular size. So it would be, from the tropical perspective, it would be the same thing to have this infinite polytope as to have this fan. If you have a finite polytope, then you somehow picked a point in the Kähler cone and made this into a Kähler manifold. It was a complex manifold once you pick a size for the polytope. But once you pick a size for the polytope, then you have picked a point in the Kähler cone. The Kähler cone is made of the all possible sizes of the polytope, and then you have a particular Kähler method. And this will be very important in the next talk. Also this one. So what do we do? Quantum toric geometry, we have all these tori. There is the C star cross C star, that's a tori that you come back to. But also, from the point of view of the moment map, the interesting finish of a point is typically a torus. And then you are going to get a real torus now, S1 plus 1. And all this tori, S1 plus 1, or you get pick a point in the boundary here, it just is one, or in a vertex, it's just a point, or tori of different dimensions, depending on the stratification. If you have a higher dimensional polytope, polyhedron, for example, then you will have S1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, or stratifying this inverse image of the moment map at every point. And this thing, you replace all this real tori by quantum tori, non-commutative tori. So you are going to replace all the tori by quantum tori. And what you get after you replace all the tori by quantum tori is a quantum toric variety. There is no longer a classical toric. And this is going to be parameterized by some h bar. In fact, by quite a few of these h bars, you will have a multi parameter deformation. And the h bars, this h bar is a vector of numbers, and bundle of numbers now, that tells you how to deform the classical toric variety into something else. From the point of view of the moment map, the classical toric variety, the image of the moment map was a polytope, but it had a property that it was a rational polytope. And this meant that all these points had rational coordinates, so that all the directions were rational. The polytope really lived in Qn, not in Rn. In this classical moment map, the polytope really lives in Qn, not in Rn. So it's a rational polytope. When I deform it into the non-commutative grid bound, what I will get is a polytope that is irrational. When it is irrational, you really get a quantum toric variety. What is rational is quantum, it becomes a classical one. So we're going to get a modular space where the rational points are the classical toric varieties, And the irrational points are the quantum toric varieties. I should also say that classical toric varieties were also famously integrable systems. There are no revealed theorem tells you that all these classical toric varieties can be construed as integrable systems. Classical integrable systems, Liouville sphere, integrable system, and you have the toric varieties of classical integrable systems. And, unsurprisingly perhaps, quantum toric varieties will be quantum integrable systems, no longer classical integrable systems, but quantum integrable systems. But they will be integrable systems in the quantum sense. And we will have a quantum of nulls, Liouville theorem, that tells you that these particular quantum integral systems that have this form, and that could be implemented in the laboratory, no problem about that, by the way. You could implement in the physics laboratory the quantum integral system. Its space would be a quantum toric variety. So you can only implement this. So it is likely that quantum toric varieties have applications in both, for example, quantum computing, and indeed, it's a direction that we have explored and I could say something about that. So these are quantum integral systems that could be implemented, light shadows. Anyway, but let's go back a little bit, and the basic block to construct all this is the quantum dots. So I should tell you how we're going to deal, or we're going to model these quantum dots. So what do people do about the quantum dots? Traditionally, people say that topological non-commutative spaces, not geometric non-commutative spaces, but just topological non-commutative spaces are the same thing as non-commutative algebras, up to an equivalence. And I'll explain this equivalence in full detail for the terms. So just as spaces, there is this Gelfand name mark correspondence that say that topological spaces are the same as commutative C star algebras of certain kind. And compact spaces are commutative C star algebras, have a unit, and so on and so forth. There's a dictionary. But the category of topological spaces is a subcategory of the category of C star algebras. Just topological spaces, no geometry yet. Non commutative topological spaces could be by definition non commutative. But now that would be a problem. This would not work very well. You need an equivalence relation in non-commutative algebra for this to work well. Once you put this equivalence relation, it's called Morita equivalence. And what this equivalence relation means is that the category of modules of the algebra is what really matters, it's not so much the algebra. So you say that two algebras are the same in this category of modules are equivalent. But if you ignore that, you can think that non-commutative spaces are non-commutative algebras, same. And of course, if they are commutated by the Gelfand number correspondence, you can recover topological spaces.
Can you remind me when two sister algebras are greater equivalent?
If they are commutative, if they are isomorphic.
In the non-commutative case.
If the category of modules over the algebras are equivalent.
With the compact operators or something like that. Is there any algebra?
I can say something. Yeah. Forget about the analysis. I just think two algebras. Okay.
What?
Just take two algebras. And then you form the category of algebras. Has objects are algebras, and morphisms are by modules.
You mean sister algebras?
Forget about theta for a moment. It can be fixed.
Convex algebras.
Let me just do the algebraic version. So a morphism between the algebra A and the algebra B is a bimorphism. And this is an arrow. And a two arrow is a map of bimodules. This is a two arrow. And this is a one arrow. And this is a two category, the two category of algebras. Then what is in this category? It is a category, not only a two category. The composition of two bimodules. It is the tensor product. And that's it. The isomorphism in this category is called Monte Cruz. Isomorphism in this category is called Monte Cruz. If you want. By the way, the quantum torus is then this algebra. It has two generators and one relation. It's not very non-commutative. But it is non-commutative, nevertheless. As soon as h is not zero, it's non-commutative. And here I must point out a warning for people that are experts in the field. Today H varies real, and it's very interesting when H varies complex. I will not consider that case today. It's very interesting, but I will not consider that case today. So that's why I write H bar and never Q. It's all confusing with the Q. But AH, this is the address called the, it's based on the lattice and operator algebra. It first appeared in Lie algebra form in the famous paper of, Nobel Prize winning paper of Max von Wern and Heisenberg, Pascal Jordan, in 1926. And only later, Manvall, in 27, in his famous masterpiece, Quantum Mechanics and Group Theory, wrote it in this form as an operator algebra. It's very easy to write. So you have this operator algebra, it's a sister algebra. And this is what people call the non-commutative torus. And why would they call it the non-commutative torus? Because you fancifully imagine that X is a circle variable, not just a variable, it's a circle variable. It's an element in C stars. So then you imagine Y as some sort of non-commutative C star. But then you say they don't want in C star, cross C star. In C star, it would be two elements of two functions, and then you would just commute them, but then you say, ah, they don't commute these two coordinates on C star. Cross C star on the C star and cross C star, and then you say, oh, they have this computation relation. But it does appear on a quantum system, like a quantum, one dimensional quantum system, this classical quantum system.
Is X and Y are supposed to be invertible or self adjoint?
Unitary. Unitary operators in a computer space. It's that nice in this case. You don't need it. It's really, really, really nice. Thanks to Bayes and Trick, in the original operators, they are now unitary, and they're only densely defined in a computer space. But these are unitary operators on computer space, because they're exponentials. And then there is a funny thing, because this is not so relevant in classical quantum mechanics, but yes to us, and then it becomes really, really an enormous thing for us. This what I call the arithmetic dichotomy, and this is not so apparent in quantum mechanics at first. So really, it's kind of funny. If
Planck's constant was rational, the world would not be quantum. This proves that Planck's constant is irrational. Let me say. For each part rational, this algebra seems patently non-convenient. But it is more equal to the algebra.
If that's the definition of a rational number.
The definition of a rational number is whether this algebra is called is more equivalent to a commutative algebra. That's the definition of a rational number. If it is rational the number, then it's more equivalent to a commutative algebra, and there is no quantumness in the world. But if it is irrational, it's not more equivalent to a commutative algebra, and there is quantumness in the world. This shows that Planck's constant cannot possibly be rational. And physicists think you are crazy because you say things like this. because it really comes from physics, but then, what does rational even mean in which unit? Think about it. Rationality is not a not a thing, you know, it's only a thing once you beat your units. So this is kind of a funny thing, isn't it? Because we know don't use units. Physicists have the advantage that they have dimensional analysis. So they know the units of each bar and all these things. They never know. They seem like they ask me what are the units of each bar, never know. You know? And then it's kind of a funny thing, isn't it? Anyway, this is the arithmetic dichotomy in quantum mechanics. Doesn't make sense, but it's very important. So, and now this is the observation of Adam Kahn that is so beautiful. Very beautiful insight from Adam Kahn. It's in his very early paper, of 1985. The long version was only published in 1990. In 1985, this is just a intimation, you know.
When did he get his first time? When was it?
Okay. Anyway, but it's even earlier. He has a conference doing it earlier. He has this insight that he immediately grasped as important. That if you have the chronic foliation, I know it's chronic foliation. You have this linear flow on the torus. It has a slope, doesn't it? Of the torus, the straight torus, and then you point with geodesics. Then you point rationally, you end up with torus knots. But if you point irrationally, then you end up with a dense foliation. That's the first example of a foliation where every leaf is dense everywhere, from measure zero and all of them. It's not even that bad of a foliation, but it's already interesting. But it's as easy as it gets, linear foliation. And this is very beautiful, the observation of Alan Kahn from this foliation. Okay, and he, to every foliation, he's going to assign an algebra. So given a foliation, Alan Kahn assigns an algebra. And to this foliation, the algebra that pops up is the algebra of the quantum torus. It's just like the algebra that we just described. So the poetic idea here is that the modular space of leaves of this foliation, there is a house on the stage, you don't see anything there, especially with the rational idea. Otherwise, it's just a separate thing. It's a bad space. So if you try to do functions, even equivariant functions, won't work very well. But if you assign this non-commutative algebra, this wants to be the space of functions of these five spaces. So once you accept non-commutative algebras as possible algebras of functions of spaces, what we're doing that the spec of a space is a non-commutative algebra. The spec of the space of the modulus, the space of leaves of this foliation, is that non-commutative algebra. That may be. So, and how do you say this idea a little bit better? Well, you give a function from these spaces that the book of stacks to add the rest. And when the stack or space is just nice, vanilla, kind, innocent, cognitive space, just a space for a little bit, then you get the usual algebra functions of the space. But when there was something there in this stack, then you get a non-cognitive function. So but I'm asymptotic in the category of these spaces that are called stacks. And completely classic, I think, but then more.
In the, for this association, I guess that when you have the foliation induced by rational, then when you look to the quotients are more equivalent for foliations in the foliation sense, like if you have a groupoid for foliations, then they should be the same for rational parameters.
It's a little bit more complicated than that, but almost. It's a little bit more interesting than that. In fact, in our case, even in these very simple cases, you start with nothing, you only start with a torus, and then you do nothing, and then you keep doing nothing, and then you get SF to Z. Mm-hmm. That is the geometric automorphisms of the torus. So you keep doing nothing, you know? So what do? You take the holonomy groupoid. What is the groupoid? The holonomy groupoid. You can say it in two ways. It's a groupoid whose objects are the points in the torus, and whose arrows are morphisms are geodesics. Then the geodesic that connects these two points. This case, this direction, the leaves of foliation connects these two points. Actually, these are one dimension. If it was higher dimension, you would take the parts of the leaf, and then you take the homotopy classes of parts and the joining these parts of the leaf. In this case, it's just. And that category is a category. That's a groupoid, because you could take that part and that part and homotopically contract the lot. So, it's like a generalization of the fundamental group, but it's the one that is groupoid, fundamental groupoid, and along leaves. Now that's the holonomy groupoid of the foliation. In this case, it's clearly equivalent to taking a transversal and saying that this is an arrow between this and this is that thing. But that's all the same as saying that is the category, the action category of the rotation by tape, by H bar on the circuit. It's clearly the same category, equivalent category. So that's the holonomy groupoid. And in this case, it's just a circle acted on by rotations of H bar. But again, if H bar is irrational, you get this non-halogen dust. But that's what it is. I just say here there is that rotation. And now, if you have groupoids, you have this way, this contour comb that gives you a non-commutative fiber. Groupoids descend to stack by something called Morita equivalence as well. Non-commutative fibers descend to non-commutative spaces by Morita equivalence, and then the comb functor is a functor from stacks to non-commutative spaces. To every stack, you can associate a non-commutative space. There is a Morita equivalence class of Morita. But example, if we have this foliation action, gives you the groupoid, if this is the real line acting on the torus, the reals acting on the torus, non-compact group action, well, the algebra is AH, and the Morita class, the equivalent class of AH, is the non-competitive torus of Alan Cohn, but then there is this stack. There's a non-separated stack, very non-separated stack. Okay, so the dramatic personae, well, these are the dramatic personae of the situation. So we have four avatars for the quantum torus. And you could get, well, this exponential isomorphism, So what do? You have the circle by rotations. This is the same thing as having R acted by one and H bar. This is the same thing as having R acted by one and H bar. So now I converted the whole thing into the whole of the story of the action on the volume is the same as having R acted by an abelian subgroup of rank two. We're not quite used to rank two, we're used to rank one, but rank two. So this is a very important part. Because this subgroup of R, I will call it gamma, and I will call it a quantum lattice. You're used to lattices, but this is obviously a lattice-like thing that when divided. But you see, now it's all confused because R divided by a lattice gives me a torus. The dimension seems to be odd, but don't they? It's a bit confusing, isn't it? Anyway, this is called a quantum lattice. People use these things in quasi-crystals and call them quasi-lattices. Mine are quasi-crystals and being projected. So they call it quantum lattice. But I would quasi-lattice, but I will call it quantum lattice. Or Q lattice, one lattice. And so you have this kind of exponential map from gamma to the rotation group. And then you have that the quantum torus is this stack, R mod gamma by the quantum lattice gamma. And, but of course, I want to do complex manifolds. So I will do the complex version. And I don't really need to do it on the real line. I could do it on RN or on CN. And I could have a generated by real things, some group, abelian group of thingies, you know, real thingies inside RD. And I could still divide this and get the quantum torus. And this is my, this stack is one, my definition of quantum torus. And the cone functor would send it to a particular operator. But today, I will just take the thing and not apply the compound. And so forget about the operator algebras. Anybody else kills me at this point. But I'm like that. So I'll just take the thing. But of course, I have all the information of the operator algebra in that thing. So why use the operator algebra? And Landian people first thought, what I do. It's okay. So a quantum torus is an analytic stack equation CD by the action of a finally generated gamma of RD, a quantum lattice. A quantum torus endowed with the operations used by the Lie group, blah, 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 is an analytic Picard stack defined in Artin, Grothendieck, Dampier, Topos theory, and the talc of a movie of skills. That's, you have the definition of Picard stack, and this thing is that kind of thing. It has a lot of parallels to come. But what this means in today is that it's just a group. The Picard stack, it just means an abelian group in the stacky world. And this is a very non-separated stack, nevertheless a Picard stack. I'm going to talk about a category. What morphisms? Picard stack morphisms from Arnie, Grothendieck, Verdier, etc. Why not? We'll do that. Definition. These are the morphisms. They are Picard stacks. I just give them the morphism of Picard stack. But worry not. That morphism is the same thing to have all that again. You know, they are so many simplified. And what you get is a map from R to RD prime, tending gamma to gamma prime. What is what you would expect? This is what happens for Torii. This is in every book in Toric geometry. Morphisms of Torii are the same thing as morphisms of lattices. Well, this is another morphism of quantum Torii. This theorem means morphisms of quantum Torii are morphisms of quantum lattices. And I look at similarity in the book of Cox for lattices. This is the theorem for quantum lattices for quantum Torii varieties. So first theorem. Well, it's harder than the classical one by an order of magnitude of
what are you doing? I mean, like,
but not hard, it's just super confusing, but not hard.
Depends on your quantum category.
But what do you want is a compactification of the quantum torus, the first quantum torus?
The one
quantum torus.
Quantum B1 is a compactification, and this is already the Hopf surface.
This is very interesting. The Hopf surface already here,
and this is very important tomorrow. So, what's going on? What am I talking about? So, how am I going to do this compactification? Well, the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to take this, I'm going to divide by this crazy group of rotations that makes this non-causal, and I'm going to do it on the other side, and then I'm going to glue these two crazy things to a bigger crazy thing. And that's how I'm going to get quantum B1. Observe that you kind of feel that pi 1 of these should be gamma, kind of thing. But this is rank 2. So all the dimension seems to be all over the place. In 2 is 1 and 2. Dimension may at first look confusing to the reader. So, the thing is that the naive dimension seems to be 2. It seems to be 1. The naive dimension, but homotopically it is not so. This thing is contracted. It doesn't count for dimension counting homologically. So it's 2, it's always 2. So CP1 has dimension 2, complete dimension. What am I talking about? So I claim that CP1 has complex dimension 2. What do I mean by this? I mean, CP1. Again, H could be rational and irrational. I mean, H equals to 0, this is CP1. For some rational number, this is this weighted derivative CP1s, CP1, 2, 3, or whatever. What is going on is the following. And this is incredibly important for tomorrow. So, the thing is that you have CP1. And here you have a complex manifold. And here you have. Traditionally, you would have CP1, a complex manifold, and an elliptic curve, and this would be the Hopf surface. And this would be an elliptic vibration. But now, think of the quantum torus. For rational, it closes itself up into circles. And this is one closes one. These are circles. Rational, it closes itself up into circles. But then, in the irrational case, it opens and the fiber is C. Notice that here E might have moduli. C does not have moduli at all. It's just C. And so when you move from H bar equals 0 to H bar not equal to 0 and irrational, then you get this. And then you get quantum P1. But not count the homotopical dimension. This is nothing. So this is homotopy equivalent to this. So this loops by the Hopf surface topologically. But as you move H bar, and this is very important for our new Hodge theory. As you move H bar, you move the complex structure.
So here is a classical Hopf surface. This is topologically still the Hopf surface topologically. This is still the strict curves as well. Still the strict curves as well. But you move the convergence of track. So as I move in the module space of dotted varieties, what is going on is that I have S3 crosses 1, and now I have all these complex structures on S3 crosses 1, all different LBM networks. Parameterized by H bar, some H bar. If I take one dimensional guy, it's just a path in module space.
So you're associating a correspondence between complex structures on this homotopy of manifold with your parameter related to plotty count.
That's right. As I move this complex structure, but this complex structure, I get various quantum toric varieties. I get these vibrations. And I claim that this is not E. I claim that this is C winding up on itself. But then, if this is not E, this is C winding up on itself. This picture is wrong. It should be this. Where this is a Riemann sphere with a gerb. It's a stack. It's still a non-commutative degree of freedom. It has turned on the B field. It has an additional little quantum field that is not only CP1, relativistic CP1, but this is quantum relativistic CP1. It has this little B field turned on. And but now we are mathematicians. And then we say, well, the category of these toric varieties with these quantum fields. It happens to be the case that the category is the same as the category of toric varieties. If I know the toric variety, this field is totally God-given, and I can turn it on. So to have this diagram and to have this diagram is the same. But if I see that this diagram, I can put it together here and form a modular space. If I don't turn on that non-commutative degree of freedom, there is no modular space. So I'm resolving this kind of a singular thing that I'm resolving so that it fits in the modular space. I don't know if you see what I mean. Yeah. So I'm resolving it, and then you really have the modular space. This is what's going on here in all this story here. And and this is the story. Think of Calabi-Ekman manifolds, same happens. Now for P1, cos P1, now to quantum P1s, and even worse than quantum P1s. Because if you could have these crazy polytope, that is super irrational, moving as a quantum P1 cross P1, that is, it no longer splits as a quantum P1 cross a quantum P1, because it has different sizes, the sides. You see what I mean? But anyway, you can do it, of course, and you have these, and tomorrow Calabi-Ekmans and Hopf surfaces will be the fundamental building blocks of our theory. And this is vetted by characteristic P calculations in another world. So the whole thing gets extremely amusing. But anyway, we have the Hopf manifolds, Calabi-Ekman manifolds. Are of this form, and you have these, and you can also deform this picture again in this kind of situation. This kind of situation. Beautiful story here. In the classical Hopf surface thing, I have this, I have the quantum toric, and then I actually have a model map, don't I? I have a polytope. Well, in this case, that's it, nothing. And then I have these. And the interesting thing is that, and I have the torus here, don't I? I have the torus. In fact, this contains a quantum torus. And what is above the quantum torus is a canonical collision. So this is a holomorphic compactification of the canonical collision. Holomorphic compactification, and it's many of them given by these things here. Only combinatorics of this. So the combinatorics gives you the holomorphic compactifications of the canonical foliations as holomorphic foliations. As holomorphic foliations. And it gives you then these pairs of compactifications for this stack, the scalar stack. And these will be scalar stacks with some conditions. We also have the non-simplicial thing. Well, Boba did that, Antoine, and other stories. But here, this is what I was saying here, that there is this thing that is kind of the germ over this thing. But to have this thing and to have the thing is to have the same thing categorically. I mean, the category of these things, and the category of these things is the same category. So when I say toy variety, given a fan, you form a toy variety, or you form a toy variety with a germ. And you forget that you have the third variety, but you have the third variety with the fan, and then with the fan you get the third variety with the germ system. So the combinatorics is so strong that it's the same thing to have the third variety. This commutative, this relativistic thing, this quantum relativistic system. A little bit of freedom that fits nicely into the equations. Okay. So quantum torus is the same. You could have the quantum, the irrational one, there's no question. It's in the nice direction. When it's rational, now you're confused. What's the wrong dimension? What's going on? Well, because a torus with a germ. But this is rational, this torus is not. And so the question is a center. What's wrong the dimension? I'm dividing T2 by R and I'm getting a circle. No, you're getting a circle with a germ. BZ, but BZ this is one, so you're getting a toroid. Dividing by R does nothing, it's okay. You said topology. I don't know if you saw what I just meant. You had T2, you divide by R, and then you get S1. No, you get S1 together with a germ. And now it's okay. The dimensions were always right. If you do it in this, always with this non-commutative degree of freedom, then there is no problem. So we discovered this five. So we have this abelian band, and so on and so forth. And this is the case of the Hopf surface. This is the case of the Hopf surface. So what is a quantum torus? The category of quantum torus, I said, had to be the category of quantum lattices. But I have the wrong definition of quantum torus. I have to take this definition of quantum torus with the germ. And now the category of quantum torus is the same as the category of quantum lattices. That's okay, the thing from toric geometry. If I put the germ, now the category of quantum torus is the category of quantum lattices. Blah, blah, blah. A lot of letters, just linear algebra. All the Hollywood is really this matrix, in the integral value matrix. Or morphisms. And so, what is a quantum lattice? I said it was a subgroup. No. A quantum lattice is a morphism from set n to R d. Typically, in R was Z2 to R1, and that was 1 and H. You see what I mean? So, it's a morphism. So, H bar is a morphism from set n to R d. That's the deformation parameter for. And this is an obvious morphism of quantum lattice. So imagine Z3, imagine the lattice from Z3, and in some direction relative to R2. Well, you get something probably dense, actually. In almost every direction is dense. So, example, this is a nice example because it allows me to have these in characteristic in the field of one element, it allows me these expressions. Over the field of one element, or this. If I have this h that goes from z2 to r1, this was the so-called quantum lattice, but really is this h what matters? H allows you to write this map from this quantum torus to this quantum torus. This map exists from this quantum torus to this quantum torus and makes sense. Now you have these monomials for telegeometry. With irrational exponents, now you have irrational pointers. You have these monomials in these very affine varieties.
So when you bar is described with different tool here.
Huh?
This H bar.
Yeah, I was for just to refer to for educational purposes as well. I'm taking H bar. And I have these monomials with these real exponents, and they make sense in this very affine variety world. And we have these very affine varieties with these irrational monomials, and we're set to go. And now these theorems in the first chapter of Cox, whatever, now you can prove them. My student, undergraduate students, proving this first chapter of Cox in this world. Now it's all undergraduates once we have the definitions. Now you have the irrational exponents, and look, there's nothing. It's okay, they are okay, you know, you have this. Polynomials, you know, thinking. So this is a typical quantum fact. A fan in the past lived on a lattice. I had some. But what did you do? You had this fan on the lattice, and then you took the primitive generator, didn't you? You took the first point to hit the lattice. And this was the length of this direction, wasn't it? Now you gotta pick your Planck's lengths. Because there is no bona fide way to say what's the primitive. So you mark the points. So you need this fan with marked points. But once you are marking points, why stop at the race? You could mark more points and have more generators for your quantum lattice. You want the mark points to be the image of Z to the N, the generator of Z, you want EM into this world. And you want those to be your mark points. It could be more than the race, than the one skeleton of the fan. Why stop at just marking the points at the end? If this is rational, then you recover the notion of Borisov and Chen and Emily and all these people of stacky fans. But if it is irrational, it's a quantum fan. I call it a quantum fan. So this is a quantum fan. There it is. So now you have a quantum lattice, and the fan lives on the quantum lattice. But the quantum lattice could need more degrees of irrationality. So you would need more things. And the rate. The rate may not cover all the degrees of transcendental of a transcendentality or anything over the thing. Well, it's an arithmetic issue. So that the quantum fan, clearly you want H, you remember H. So it's a calibrated quantum fan. And now calibrated quantum fan is a quantum Tauri variety. When you have a calibrated quantum fan, so now you can start forming H. You carry your points and you carry your rays, and you move edge, you carry your rays, and you carry your mark points. You see what I mean? Imagine moving edge, if you locate this thing here and do something. Then you carry your rays around, and imagine the moment polytop moving into irrational polytops and doing things. Can you see it? As you move edge bar. Now, the classical quantum torus, I didn't say it, but it's a beautiful, beautiful story. That was first proved with Fitzgerald, it was hard, and then you can prove it with Stax, easy. H gave the same torus as H2 if H1 was
A plus B H 2 over C plus B H 2 in GL to Z.
Not this transformation.
In SL to Z.
This is kind of clear from the static point of view. The foliation is isomorphic, homomorphic is isomorphic. Card from the with the definition of sister algebras, this is a card theorem of Riffle. But now it's easy.
This is supposed to be one of the modules and these are the evidence of the module.
It's okay, but you have to do something.
There's some notion of conformality somehow from structures in a sense. Like if something were you would put some metric in on it, remaining in this case as well.
You don't need a metric, it's really, even just the stack is really just the same stack. By the way, this is a calibrated quantum bank, and now this is the object that will give you a quantum toric variety. The quantum toric variety, I can tell you how to make the cones in the one cone, and I can tell you how to do the cones using this homotopy pullback diagram in the category of Chomp scalar stacks. You take this collimated diagram given by the kind of thing. But now you can take this collimate in this category, blah 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 blah, homotopy collimate in the category of scalar. And, it's too long already. Let me just say, you could do examples, very nice examples. You know, this is P2. It's quantum P2 and the module space of quantum P2. Now it's clear that you could do a module space. There is geometric invariant theory in this world. You can also do it using the gauge transform. Let me just stop here a little bit because tomorrow we'll use this critically. And then I will stop. These three moments. I started already an hour ago, so I should stop. If you give me a quantum fan, I can produce a quantum toric variety and stack, a Keller stack. But if you give me this data, these vectors, the mark points, the vectors that are the mark points, and you still have the combinatory. But if you give me the vectors that are the mark points, the model space, you can do duality and get this. So this is it. This is H. The kernel of H is A. It's called game duality. Just getting the kernel of H of game duality. Same information as H. The dual of H is A. Tomorrow will be called lambda, not A. It will be called lambda. 1, lambda, 2, lambda, what we call lambda, not A, but it looks like A. And just from the lambda, just from the A, just using the usual geometric invariant semi-stable kind of story, you can get this kind of definition of the quantum toric stack. The one thing divided by one thing. If you restrict this thing to some piece, then you get just chronological foliations stratified. And then when you do the quotient, you get this compactification. So you get this geometric invariant theory thing. But the geometric invariant theory, the action is given by this lambda, this H, that is the kernel of H. So they are, you have this geometric invariant theory. I will use A tomorrow, not. I won't use the fan. I will use the Gale dual of the fan tomorrow. For the Hodge theory. The Hodge theory is more naturally expressed in terms of A than of V, than of H. The deformation parameter H bar, you need the Gale dual of H bar to express the Hodge theory. That's actually what I will show tomorrow. The Hodge theory is expressed in terms of V. Gay dual. And well, we have all these stories. Very beautiful. Kaler, a quantum fan. Quantum theory is Kaler if and only if the fan is polytopal. If the fan is not polytopal, you will still get a complex stack, but you, but it's no longer Kaler. It's no longer Kaler. You are just in a purely complex situation with no symplectic structure. Once a symplectic structure, you need the and this is very natural, same, but it's true. And let me just say that, well, you have more spaces. As you move h bar, you get more space. But h bar is related to h bar by this kind of relations, arithmetic groups. So you have this kind of thing divided by this kind of arithmetic groups. So, just very quickly, you have some type Miller theory and a twister bundle complexification. Blah, 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 blah. This is the simplest topological situation, and this is an arithmetic group. You have this combinatorial situation of the arithmetic group, and you have some examples. And then you get, well, here you get the algebra by the namespace of the Hilbert group, or the classifier space of the symmetric groups. Or, and you get to compute the topology of these spaces, you need to compute group cohomology for arithmetic groups. Anyway, you have the module spaces and they have topology. Okay, and the obstruction to computing the topology of these spaces. It's a beautiful story. For example, it's fascinating that it's super fascinating. You have these, and you perturb. Sometimes just like nothing the polytopal world, it could be the case that there is no algorithm. You can prove that there is no algorithm to computer perturbation. There's no computer algorithm that computer perturbation. The whole thing is very interesting. It's extremely interesting computationally speaking. Non-simplicial fans, low off, irrational morphisms, cobordisms, and these cobordisms are very important. You have a new flavor of birational geometry. You have this new flavor of birational geometry. And I will talk about it tomorrow. There has to be, and this is just the story part, but we don't know. Complex manifolds don't have these, but these are complex manifolds that are not. These are complex manifolds that are not algebraic. And one can show that all these manifolds that appear are non-algebraic. You have all these terms, but we know that for complex manifolds you don't have these. So there has to be a world where this is happening, and this is what Ludwig Jung saw. Loran and I have set up to untangle a little bit. And we have understood a lot of what's going on, and tomorrow we will explain why is it possible that we have all these things. Even there seems to be a weak factorization theorem for things, but this cannot possibly be true for complex manifolds, also for so many reasons. So what's going on? So this is the subject of tomorrow's talk. Here I do some examples of the module for PDs, and there is a universal family, there is a compactification. Just like curves compactify, you know, the module space of curves, you have MGM for the module space of curves. Now for this module space, you have MGM, where M is the number of marked points, and G is the combinatorics of the family. So the analog of the genus of a Riemann surface for these things is the combinatorics of the time. So the combinatorics of the time should become the genus of the toric surface. It contains the Betti numbers, and you just count, don't you? You just count cones, don't you? So it contains the Betti numbers, contains the rational homology. So so this is the G, and the N is the number of gerbs, the rank of the gerbs. Or the number of marked points in the pattern that corresponds to the rank of the gerb. And so, so you have this number of, and as I increase the rank of the gerb, all I do here is topologically I just multiply by pairs of circles. But the complex structure changes magically, you know, just adapts to the space, the complex structure, in a completely non-linear way. It's a PDE that you would have no idea how to solve if I write down this PDE. It's just you say, how do you deform the justice complex structure into this? You see what I mean? Well, you have to do this PDE with this boundary condition, impossible thing, you know, absolutely impossible. But it just does it. And now, this modular space, you kind of do the combination. You say this ray moves, this cone disappears, da da. So I take the modular space of this smaller thing and glue it to this modular space and blah, 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 this is P2. And then you get the universal family, the compactification of the big modular space of all toricomplexes in all dimensions. You have the big modular space that has all the toric objects in all dimensions. It's a cosimplicial stack. It's a cosimplicial object category of Kähler stacks. And well, the modular space, I mean, the modular space, don't get confused, the modular space is just an orbital. So it's a cosimplicial orbital, because the arithmetic group acts with finite stabilizers. All these arithmetic groups will act with finite stabilizers. So it's a cosimplicial orbital. And and one proof, the big modular space conjecture, which is this, that is in, within the proprietary space, but then he just did it for. The problem for here, the obstruction was you needed non simplicial fans, and Petra will need them with simplicial fans. But to really deform, at some point you are going to pass through non simplicial fans. He did it. Beautiful, sorry. That's it. Thank you very much.